Welcome. My name is Stefan Kulo, or just Kulo, I will be enough. I work for SUSE in the OpenSUSE team as the release manager of the OpenSUSE distribution for almost 7 years now. I think in July it will be 7 years. And I want to talk about about Better Factory and what we did over the last couple of months to improve the usability of Factory. And so what is the actual problem that we faced? The problem might not be too obvious if you just used OpenSUSE releases that we used to release every 8 months, because they were okay. They were okay. But the problem is that the Factory, which is the development version of it that we release it from, is growing over the years. And actually, it's growing a lot since like 3 years. And the underlying problem is that we use the same development process for here, and for here, and for here. Oops. And at some point, we had to realize that we have to change the development model a bit so we can adopt to the new gradient this curve has now. And the big problem is that the changes done to Factory are not too well tested. So I don't imply bad intentions by the people, but in the end, the better they would test the changes, the better the end product would be, but it's not. And the thing is, we have a lot of these changes. There used to be a time when it was normal that we had 200 changes a week, like here. This is, by the way, changes per week. By now, we are happy if we below 600 a week. So this is also a number that has grown over the years. It is significantly more difficult to handle with the current development process. So over the last years, we introduced several mechanisms that try to help. We have some script that is called Factory Auto, which is reviewing parts of the sources so that the smaller mistakes are already seen by a machine, that the source URL is valid, that the patches are applied, that there is no set badness in the RPM lint RC, stuff like that, that humans always have to check like robots. So we actually introduced a robot so that the human beings have more time for quality reviews. We introduced a bot that is called Legal Auto that checks the submissions for changed licenses and if the license is in compliance to our policies. I mean, for example, being GPL or MIT or BSD and what else the open source world has to offer. We have a so-called repo checker that checks the submitted package that it actually built in the project it was submitted from, and smaller stuff. And lately, also, this repo checker will try to install the package on a factory and see if the package have dependency problems or file conflicts or something that is actually pretty hard to find for a human, for a packager. So very often it's just the package that it just did not know that it's not impossible, that it's impossible to install, because he added a requirement to a package he has, but that is not yet in factory, or file conflicts are even easier to introduce to some package you don't even know exists, and stuff like that. So, and in the end, we have the OpenSUSE review team, which is 7 by now. We lately upstuffed it a bit, who do review submissions for packaging bugs. So they actually do look at the diff and try to see the problems. And after all that, our current mechanisms are gone. So that's basically all we have right now. So we rely on the packager, and basically the one submitted the package. But the problem is that those guys, if you ask them, they are fine with the package. They know what they did, and that's perfectly fine. That's one of the basic problems. So then my job after all these reviews is to put 600 changes a week, I remember you, in one bottle, mix it, and try to make a nice juice out of it. And it's really hard to know if it will work out or not, but the factory user will use the juice right out of the bottle. So I pick the ingredients, put it in the bottle, mix it, and then give it someone to drink. This is basically what you have to imagine. And so it's really amazing that we got so far, to say it bluntly. So I take what I get, it's reviewed, I accept it, I put it in factory, I wait for factory to finish building the mix, the images, see it in QA, and then see. So sometimes the package does not even build in factory, even though it built in the project it was submitted from, which can have several reasons I don't want to go into. Sometimes other packages that are on first glance unrelated to it fail to build, like a Python update breaks Vim out of the blue because Vim has Python bindings that are very specific to the Python version. Sometimes it's impossible to install because some library interfaces changed without the repo checker noticing. And sometimes it's just like that. So it's just basically my picture for a bloody mess. Sometimes I get up and look what happened overnight and I think, yeah, I'm basically speechless in my thoughts. And the ways that factory can break are endless. I had to learn that. And whenever I thought I have seen everything, then something new comes along. And so the problem is, if you had accepted 600 changes, mixed it, gave it someone to drink, and he said, it's a bit salty, then you have to find out which of the ingredients caused that. It requires a lot of experience to get it all, and even then it's pretty hard. So just one example that comes to my mind is the GMP library. I don't know who of you know that. It's some math stuff. Was changed very slightly, just some optimization enablement, and all of factory built fine, but the live CDs did not boot. I should have told the story from the other way, but you figure it. The thing was that the tool that generates the live CD init RDs used some mathematical expression to calculate how much free space it should reserve while booting, and this always returned zero because of a bug in the tool that used the library. So, but my task is always finding out why the live CDs don't build, and then I have to dig into all the pieces. And in the end, when I'm done, I can tell the one who submitted the library, here, your library caused the live CDs no longer to build, and then he will tell me that that he knew that already, but that the bug can be caused, but he did not expect anyone to use that function, but it's already done then. So the solutions I came up with, and interestingly enough, Fedora at the same time, independently of each other, I assume, are what we both call rings, and it means splitting the huge factory base into subsets. And so the first, actually the zeroth, I don't know, ring is the bootstrap of OpenSUSE. It contains of 96 packages like GCC, binutils, glibc, tickle, bash, really the root of all evil. You can't remove any of them without causing the bootstrap cycle to fail. But this, it is building in a cycle. So it's really, you can't say where it starts and where it ends. The build service somewhere decides that it's now done with building this, but it can build for a while. And on top of that, there's the ring one that is minimal X, which generates a test DVD with a very minimal X that basically can run an X term on ICEVM. And it contains 941 extra packages, the X stuff, YAS stuff, the stuff needed for the DVD, Kiwi, for example, to build the actual DVD, plenty of Python, plenty of Perl, and stuff like that. So it's this is the graph of how long it takes to rebuild that project. And this actually does start somewhere, it's here, and it's done after almost 6 hours if we rebuild this from scratch, and with having unlimited workers, which it's unlikely. So, and on top of these two, there is two more rings that I created, but are only in a very raw state. That is main desktops and DVD. The first mentioned has 875 packages and contains KDE and GNOME stuff that is used to or required to build the current GNOME and KDE live CDs. And on top of that, another almost 1,200 packages that are required to build the current OpenSUSE DVD. That is the one we ship as milestone 0 or 1. So, but if you do your math, this leaves over 4,000 packages as nice to have, as contrib, as actually removing one of them would not be noticed by that many people, but they are still there and they still can break. But the consequence is we have to limit our scope if we want to continue growing that number. So the idea was that we have just one ring of fire. That's actually some US attraction, and limit our testing to the ones that are really important and create so-called staging projects. These are projects in the build service that start with OpenSUSE factory staging and then currently have a letter. It's to talk to each other. If something breaks, it breaks in A or in B or in C, and it queues submissions independently of each other and creates groups of submissions that are reviewed together, are tested together, and are, and that's the most important part, accepted together. So if I, for example, the first one, this is the only one that also includes the bootstrap packages. If I test bash, Lua, and ncurses together in one staging project, it means it has built one test DVD with one minimal X, and it was tested. That one DVD was tested, and I can't say that accepting them individually would be good enough because I only tested this mix, so I also accept them as this mix. And you see there are some empty ones and some larger ones. This has to do with how interconnected the packages are. There's, for example, in this scenario here, we had the C one was adopting YAS to the new systemd, and we have the H1, which is adopting YAST to the new branding. And all these components of YAST have to be changed for the installation to work again. It's pretty hard to believe that it's so many different aspects of a distribution that have to fight together, but it's actually the problem we had before, that you take one and then it's broken, and then you have to wait for another one, and then it's broken again, and then go on and go on and go on. And in this scenario with the staging projects, we have a broken staging project and we leave these packages there till we have a mix that works as a whole. And only then we go into factory, and then we have a new base that the new staging projects work on. These staging projects have actually copies of factory. They are not affected by factory changes, so they basically are branches at a specific point in time. And we have a good and tested factory base. We fork the 941 packages, test the changes on top of them, and if it's good enough, we merge that branch, and for each of these letters, we do it individually. So how it was done in detail is that factory submissions get a new reviewer. It's an OBS concept, and this reviewer is called factory staging. This is currently me and Thomas Schwartwall. It's a group of people, and the staging plugin lists what submissions to Ring packages are pending, and then one of us has to pick a letter basically. So you look at the screen and then I say, okay, YAS country belongs to the YAS stack C, so I put YAS to country in C and AA base in A, and NTP gets in D because it's free, the staging project. And so I have a queue of submissions, I sort them into one of the staging projects, and then the machine continues after that. So the staging projects build DVDs, as I mentioned already. These DVDs are automatically fetched into OpenQA, OpenSUSE.org, and they are tested as a staging DVD, and we only have one test for them running, that is MinimalX, which it's a bit biased here because it's always I and C that is red here, but usually it's only one or two staging projects that are red and the rest is green. And but you can see here you find your letters again, C, B, D, I, A, and so you can see what staging projects are show what problems. So I would go now and check what is broken in H, if it's a YAS crash or an X crash or whatever, and then try to do a bug report or something. Short question?
So you use a letter, one of these projects, for a set of stuff you want to test together. Do you, and then once that's done, that's kind of done, and you can reuse that letter for the next set of stuff? That's how you do it, yeah. Okay.
So I started with having meaningful names for these projects, and then I had to throw away everything in them and do something else, but in the end we came around with letters. Yeah. And I also rebranch them. Once they are accepted or merged into factory, I rebranch factory and then put new changes on top. So for acceptance, the Ring packages need more than the non-Ring packages. So the non-Ring packages are right now those that are not in Bootstrap or MinimalX. Those are ignored. They just take what we had before. what I mentioned, the Autobots. And the ring packages have to fulfill several requires. That is that all packages in that project have to build. I mean, like all of them. Then the test DVD has to build. The test DVD has also to pass OpenQA tests in 100%. And there can't be any requests. Some can't be newer requests for the package. That's in OBS terms. This is called superseding requests. So if some bash is submitted, it is tested. But if then a new bash is submitted, it invalidates the old bash, and then I can't accept the A. So we have some dashboard. I actually put it in EM in there, but it's, and you see it in italic there. So it's just a script, and the color code is actually added just for the presentation. So, but we have, it checks the letters, and you can see in F, for example, there's the project has built, the project has been tested, but there are still reviews pending from the reviewers I talked about. The G is acceptable, everything, all of the conditions I just mentioned are fulfilled, and H shows not just failed packages, the build failures, but also test failures in OpenQA. That's what the tool tells me, and then I can or cannot look into details why. So, and then I would go, seeing G is acceptable and actually accepted, and then it's merged into factory, all five as once. So, this basically means that my role is no longer the one mixing the bottle, but I'm actually the one who says most of the time, no, but, because I have the informations now. I can actually tell them it is not working. I can actually fiddle around a bit with the staging project. If I accepted 10 in one project, I can look at the failures and split out those that are most likely the cause and put them in an extra letter, and then can accept the other one if they succeed without the disturbing factor. And I can just decline things and tell them, here's the OpenQA test that failed, check yourself. Download the ISO, install them locally, whatever you'd want to do, but it's not going into factory. And that's lead to the fact that we had no regressions in factory worth mentioning in 2014, even though I have to admit that after I put this slide into my presentation, my laptop kinda behaves cursed, but it's unrelated, I tell you that. So the
user error,
exactly. Now the thing is, there are several. So are we done with this whole? Is factory usable again? Is usability of factory improved? Unfortunately, we are not even close to it, because there can, as I just mentioned, still so many things go wrong. Actually, as I mentioned, we only run one test for this test DVD, but for a rolling release, for a factory, we have to test a lot more. And this is the OpenQA display of the current, or the previous snapshot of factory. And you see there's a lot of red. All the DVD tests. What you don't know is that the number to reach is something like 40, and it reaches like 10. After 10 tests, it finds a fatal test and exits, because something is fishy in the actual installation process once there's a slideshow in Yast. But we don't know, because the minimal X test does not check the slideshow. But the OpenQA test for the real thing test that. And So there are some green and there are some gray, actually, like 44, 45. And there's, yeah, but in the end, it's still not good enough to be released as a milestone, too, or at least not. I come to this later. So what can go wrong still is that KDE and GNOME are not, or and even more, are not part of the staging project, so they are not tested. So we just ignore them and accept them just as we used to. We don't test FTP installations, we don't test live installations, we don't test applications in general, like Firefox can be completely busted, LibreOffice can be completely busted, stuff like that. All will appear in factory and still be broken. And in the end, for me as a factory user, this is, by the way, a factory laptop, it does not really matter if the installation or the reinstallation would work, because if I can't show you this presentation right now, I can't show you the presentation, no matter what the reason was. And the whole mixture of two staging projects that were green on their own can still go wrong, even though the chances are much, much, much less. But still, because we branch at some point and then rebase, there's an open window for regressions to slip in. So what we need is more hands on OpenQA. As you can see, OpenQA, you can't see it here, but here, there's a lot of tests that need to be checked. And there needs to be more tests, actually. We have Bernhard already had a quite good coverage, and the OpenSUSE team increased it, but it still has a lot of potential. And I think Ludwig will have a workshop tomorrow on how to write tests. I invite you to join that, because this is, if you know a bit Perl, it's really easy to write a test, and it's everything that we test before it's released will not be buggy. I plainly tell you that. And once the tests have been run, they need to be reported, so filed into Bugzilla, and most of the time I don't have the time, so I just leave them. And the real problem is that you need to really look at the tests and see if OpenQA is the problem, or if the code is the problem, because the way OpenQA works can go wrong at points. So it checks the screenshot, and is it mine? No. And if the screenshot looks different, then it will be a failure. But this might not mean that the failure is only because the screen changed in a way that the human being would not consider a bug. For example, right now the Yast theme changed from gray, black on gray to white on black or something. No designers here, I can call it white. But this is not actually a bug, but a feature. But OpenQA sees it as a failure, and you need to adopt the screenshot needles. Or the needles is the OpenQA term for that part of the screen. So what the next steps are that we actually replace factory with a tested factory and have what we have right now as factory as an interim state. We have an OpenSUSE factory 2 test project that factory releases into, that is tested, and from there it will be published into the repository that users will actually use. But only some requirements on that snapshot are fulfilled, like OpenQA being green. And we want to have a nice dashboard that you can see as a factory user how factory looks like at the moment, what the problems with the current reviews are, what the number of requests are, what the number of failed tests were, and stuff like that. So basically everything you need to use factory, which is not so much. And I made a small draft this morning, so it's just a joke. So to summarize, what we've done is that the rings, splitting factory into rings, has proven to be really worth it. We have no factory tested yet, but we believe that it's really not too far away. So we have so we reached the deadline was that we have a public open QA testing factory and showing what it means and discuss here what it means to have a factory tested. Just, I mean, what are the requirements? We need your feedback on that. And we need more hands, more people to understand the general workflow and the general open, the QA-ness of that process, because we need packages and users to let me turn it differently. We have to move packages from billions to actual contributors and users from victims to bug reporters. Basically, everyone in that process has to shift his role a bit, and this is the Spanish I promised in the previous talk. And no Spaniards here, huh? So this means a mover like culo heist means move your ass, basically. So just to get your connection to. So are there any questions or feedback or offers to help or praises or?
So yeah, the rings is an interesting idea. We have the same problem of too many packages, some of which aren't very important, and everything treated the same. Where's the metadata for that living? Do you put it in packages, saying this package is part of ring 0 and above, or do you just have package lists? And if you just have lists, how do you make sure they're internally consistent when dependencies change later?
So I have the build service, and these rings are actually build service projects. And the Bootstrap project is a project of 96 packages, and this is basically the metadata. And the minimal X is a project of 941 packages.
Okay, so packages,
and they build. This project builds, and as such, it's guaranteed that it's consistent. And I have a small helper that removes things that are no longer necessary. Sometimes requires are dropped, okay. So I try to keep this minimal as possible.
So a package doesn't know what ring it's in; it's just defined at the project level.
Yes.
Okay. Do you use libdoes or CUDF or any of those analysis tools for doing dependency sets?
The build service offers that for me.
Yeah, but what does it use? Because it's an NP-complete problem. It's hard to do package dependency set sums.
Yeah, but I just need the minimal set of things so I can use the connected graph and remove every edge that is not connected, and then I have a minimum. I don't need the best subset because I know that is okay. I know the optimized function.
Right.
I actually left quite some room for discussion and questions.
Yeah, sorry I was late. Can you start over?
No problem with that. So my name is Stefan Kulo. So actually my talk is I won't be able to publish slides for obvious reasons, but this is the URL of my talk if you want to see the slides. But you can also check the video. Okay.
How much more work is that causing for you? Or is it even less because you have not to back too many big package piles?
It is a bit, actually it used to be a lot more work because I had to dig into all kind of different informations. But now that this dashboard script is there, I basically call twice a day these scripts and separate this, and then I have to debug staging projects that used to be factory debugging, and so it's, I would say it's actually less work because OpenQA is already included in the check-in process basically. So, but initially it was indeed more work, but it's I think it will be even less if the tools become better and better. For example, I already consider getting an email automatically if a staging project becomes acceptable or is definitely failed, because right now I have to poll quite some time of the day to see if something changed or some new failure happened, some stuff like that.
So as you mentioned, when things finally come together in factory, although things work in staging project A and B, there is a remaining risk that it blows up when they finally merge. Are you just accepting that as the, well, leftover risk to deal with it? Or are you looking at eventually serializing the process and saying things don't go into factory until there is another final build with the two merged branches?
Let me show the slide you were not seeing. It takes, theoretically, the minimum time to build a ring is about 6 hours, and that does not include the testing and does not include my polling. So what you're asking for would mean to wait another day for something to accept. No, let me finish. And the main problem is that while this goes on, the developers are actually working on it. So the chances are high that I get a new just while this is going on, and then I have to discard everything again. And then wait another 2 days. In these 2 days, there might be C finished, and then I would have to start over again. So I would never finish. And that is way too much to ask for a very small risk, actually.
Right. I mean, I'm very familiar with these problems of staging and stuff. So that's why I'm asking. Are we just accepting this final risk as this is the cost of the staging model and we'll live with it? And then somebody, probably you, will fix the carnage of the explosion when it happens. Although it will happen probably less often than we had in the old model, I grant that. But somebody will still have to clean up when those two things come together and it does explode.
Yes. But the thing is that if it happens, I still know what letters were accepted, and kinda can backtrack more easily what happened, because I have the rings. The rings are basically independent of the staging project, because I still don't have to check all of them. I can still say, I mean, there was, I think 2 weeks ago, OpenSSL change that removed some symbols, and it was perfectly fine in a staging project that rebuilds everything, but it broke in factory because factory does not rebuild everything. So there's still a lot of tweaks here and there to do, and those won't go away, but the confidence level I have in this whole thing increased like 900%. And this is, I'm not, and it will be it will be even more for users when they only get what's tested.
Right.
So, but because this is only helping me in the end. This is helping me and the helping me and my communication with the developers.
Right. So, are you? Is there a plan to add functionality where you can pull out the last branch or one of the two branches that you merged? So, if you're merging A and B, staging trees A and B, and then the result is toxic, can you pull out one of those and then get basically immediately back to a good state and say, sorry, B, you're going to have to try again? Or are you planning to just fix that in factory then?
I assume it never happened so far, this toxic situation, and I don't plan to optimize for that. And so my answer would be, we wait and see.
So you said you haven't got rings for GNOME and KDE yet. Any particular reason why?
The reason why is that I wanted to work down up, or from the base up. So I wanted to have this process running before I think about next steps. And the next steps don't necessarily have to be KDE and GNOME, because KDE and GNOME will mean another 19 hours to build and even more to test. The next steps could also be to do more tests with these staging DVDs. For example, the I'm not sure if you were there, but I mentioned that my laptop behaved weird, and the reason it behaved was that the update of Drakut left my crypt LVM or my crypt setup on LVM broken, because it did not include the driver for something in the initRD. And this is something that we do not test with the staging DVDs, and that we only test with the factory tested. So we could do this earlier to catch these bugs earlier, but we can also say that we rely on the next step, because the bugs will only hit the users if it ends in factory tested. But then again, if we catch too few bugs in that in the early state, we will never get a new factory tested and have basically just moved the level of problem we have. But these thoughts and these solutions to these problems, I wanted to first discuss once this problem is done, and this means having the tools for that basically running fine, and we're getting there. So.
So how did you decide what your ring sets were? Is it just you decided, nobody else gets to choose, or?
Just like with everything else, yeah. Okay. No, it's I pushed the idea to the factory mailing list on what rings might be, and did not get any alternative suggestions. So I tried them, and it worked out pretty well. At least these two. Okay. I'm not actually the next ring. It might make sense to split it into first KDE or first GNOME and then KDE, so that you can have one stage earlier to see that it fails.
There's presumably quite a big range between the minimal set of KDE that would boot and everything that normally goes into the whole desktop with a whole pile of applications. So,
it's the biggest problem with the next ring is that it introduced Java, and Java is at the moment in OpenSUSE impossible to bootstrap. You have to have Java to build Java, mm-hmm. which introduces another problem that I don't have a good solution for that. I discussed it with the Java packager, and he left the company shortly afterwards. But this is something that I would target at some point. To answer that question, yeah. Okay. Perhaps next year then. Okay, no more questions? Then thank you for your attention.